فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
فصل. وأصول الفقه طرقه على سبيل الإجمال وكيفية الاستدلال بها. ومعنى قوله وكيفيته الاستدلال بها ترتيب الأدلة في التقديم والتأخير أو ما يتبع ذلك من أحكام المجتهدين. فصل. وأبواب أصول الفقه أقسام الكلام والأمر والنهي والعام والخاص، ويذكر فيه المطلق والمقيد والمجمل والمبين
والمبين
والمبين والظاهر والمؤول والأقوال
والمؤول
والمؤول والأقوال والأفعال والناسخ والمنسوخ والتعارض والإجماع والأخبار والقياس والحظر والإباحة واستصحاب الحال وترتيب الأدلة وصفة المفتي والمستفتي وأحكام المجتهدين.
The author رحمه الله, he finished defining أصول الفقه باعتبار مفرديه. He defined أصول الفقه, أصول and فقه. He finished that. Now he followed it up with defining أصول الفقه together. We said before, والمفرد المضاف إن تركب مع غيره حتى أتم لقبا فحده يكون بالإفراد لكل واحد لدى النقاد ثم يعاد ثانيا مركبا إذ لقبا لديهم تركبا. So now he is going back to defining أصول الفقه باعتبار كونه لقبا لجملة من مسائل العلم. He's now going back to أصول الفقه together. What does أصول الفقه mean together? You know what أصول means. What was أصول? في اللغة أساس الشيء. And he said وهو يبنى عليه غيره. But we said قاعدة المستمرة. Then فقه, what did we say? الفقه في اللغة means what? الفهم. لغة الفقه means لغة. What does it mean? وما لهؤلاء القوم لا يكادون يفقهون أي يفهمون. نبي الله موسى سأل ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أي يفهم قولي. So the word فقه means فهم لغة. اصطلاحا what did it mean? معرفة الأحكام الشرعية المكتسبة من أدلتها التفصيلية. That's the correct definition that we would choose for. But the author said معرفة الأحكام الشرعية التي طريقها الاجتهاد, right? That's what he said. Now we finished أصول and فقه. We're now going into أصول الفقه together. What does it both mean? He says وأصول الفقه طرقه على سبيل الإجمال وكيفية الاستدلال بها. So two things is what أصول الفقه is. Somebody asks you what is أصول الفقه. The author يجمع بين الأمرين في تعريفه. In his definition he brought two things. First one is طرقه. The ha goes back to fiqh. So طرق الفقه على سبيل الإجمال. أصول الفقه is path is قواعد, principles. أصول الفقه is قواعد. على سبيل الإجمال means قواعد, principles. أصول الفقه doesn't talk about sub-branches and whatnot. It gives you comprehensive principles. This is the difference between fiqh and أصول الفقه. Fiqh is what? Not أدلة إجمالية. أما it's not طريقه على سبيل الإجمال is not. فقه is what? فقه is what? على سبيل التفصيل. فقه is sub-branches. I'll give an example. Allah subhanahu, sorry, the ulama they say الأمر تقتضي الوجوب. الأمر تقتضي الوجوب. The scholars they say that the amr, the command, it shows obligation. The command, what does it show? It shows obligation. This is it general? Yes. It's ijmali, it's comprehensive. Why is it ijmali and why is it comprehensive? Because I can use it for any amr. I can use it for aqim al-salah. I can use it for wa'atu al-zakah. I can use it for any amr ورد في القرآن والسنة. I can use it. It's not specific to a particular chapter. It's general. It enters any khitab shar'i. Any sharia addressing matter, I can use this qa'idah, because that's what it is, usul al-fiqh. Fiqh on the other hand, when you talk about al-wudu shart al-salah, wudu is the shart of salah. Is this ijmali? Can it enter any other chapter other than salah? Can it? Brothers, I'm asking a question. Can it? No, we don't. This is tafsil, specific. You're talking about shart al-salah, specific. It's only specific to salah. Are you with me? Istiqbalu al-qibla is a condition for the prayer. Qira'at surah al-fatiha is ruknu min arkani salah. It's a pillar from the pillars of the salah. This is tafsili. You're now going into details. Are you with me, brothers? Lakin usul al-fiqh is the qawa'id, principles, where many chapters of fiqh enter, you take it back to. Are you with me? That's why usul al-fiqh, to have it, saves more time than studying fiqh. Because now when I know al-amru taqtadi al-wujub, that the Prophet commands something, it shows obligation. Every time a command comes, by default, I know it's obligatory. Whether I find it in Babul Jinayat, Qisas, I find it in Kitab al-Nikah, wherever I find a command, I have this with me. Is it a command? Did the Prophet command it? It's obligatory then. Does that make sense? لذلك, the people who study fiqh, don't study usul al-fiqh, they suffer. The reason is because studying so many sub-branches, you get tired and time doesn't allow it. You won't live for too long to study every furu'. Does that make sense? Whereas when you study the qawa'id al-usuliyya, when you study usul al-fiqh, 20 issues that you may not even see in your life, just by studying this qa'idah, whenever you see it, you're like, oh, it's the first time I see it, but all I know is al-amru taqtadi al-wujub. Does that make sense? Also, lakin, to study qawa'id fiqhiyya, you also need to know furu', because the qa'idah that you have, you need an example for it. And what about if you don't even understand the example is a problem? So they need each other. A faqih requires an usuli, and an usuli requires a faqih. They need each other. Just by knowing usul al-fiqh doesn't mean you're a faqih. And just because you're a faqih doesn't mean you're an usuli. Make sense? They all need each other. This is the underlying difference. Are you with me? So the first point the Sheikh mentions in his definition is طُرُقُهُ عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْإِجْمَالِ. The second point that he mentions is وَكَيْفِيَّةُ الْإِسْتِدْلَالِ بِهَا. The second thing is how to benefit from the evidences. It talks about general principles, not one. Second thing is how can I benefit from these evidences? This in summary is called دَلَالَاتُ الْأَلْفَاظِ. We already mentioned it. The دَلَالَاتُ الْأَلْفَاظِ. We mention al-amru, wal-nahyu, ya, wal-mutlaq, wal-muqayyad, wal-mujmal, wal-mubayyan, wal-nasr, wal-nas, al-zahir. Are you with me, brothers? What do you call it? Al-nasr. Even the tarjih. Even the ta'arud and the tarjih. All of these are kayfiyyatu istidlali biha. This dalil, how do I benefit from it? This dalil shows am, general. This is specific. This is specific. Okay. The am and the specific, if they are opposing each other, how do I reconcile between the two? I take the khas over the am. This is how I benefit from the evidences. This dalil is how do I extract the ruling from it? Remember when we were studying thalathatul usul, this is what I kept bringing home to you guys. Having the dalil, how do I extract the evidence from the dalil? That's called kayfiyyatul istidlal biha. The author left another point that many scholars add onto it. Another point that they add to it when they define it, which is called وَحَالُ الْمُسْتَدِلِ. Some scholars call it وَحَالُ الْمُسْتَفِيدِ. What does it mean, حَالُ الْمُسْتَدِلِ? This is the issue of the mufti, the mustafti, the shurut of the mufti, the conditions that the mufti has to come with, who is a mufti, who can give fatwa, who is a muqallid, who is a blind follower, and etc. and the different types of mujtahideen that there are, mujtahid mutlaq and unrestricted mujtahid, a restricted mujtahid, restricted to a madhab, and etc. This is called halul mustadil. The one who can benefit from the text. Who is the one who can benefit from the text? Are you with me, brothers? Three things is the definition that the scholars mentioned for usul al-fiqh. What is it? Adillatul ijmaliyah, wa kayfiyatul istifadati minha, wa halul mustafid. The first one is comprehensive and general principles. Second thing is how to benefit from the textual evidences. And the third, which is the last one, the one who has the right to go to the textual evidences and extract the ruling from it. Is everyone allowed to go to the textual evidences and directly extract the ruling from it? Is everyone allowed? No. Because a muqallid exists. Are you with me? And there's a mujtahid. Now everybody can go, قال الله تعالى. Not everyone can say, قال رسول الله. صح. This is, it has a حال المستدل. The situation of the person who's using the evidence is important. So this is called قواعد الفقهية. With these three conditions, the scholars, they call this قواعد, أصول الفقه, they call it. They call this أصول الفقه. The last two that were mentioned, the last two that I mentioned, how many points did I mention for أصول الفقه? Three, right? The last two, what were the last two? Huh? How to benefit from the evidences. The third was what? And who can benefit from it? The situation of the one who wants to benefit from it. Those two are really not the definition of usul al-fiqh in and within itself. They are what is taught and studied in usul al-fiqh. Does that make sense? Are you with me? The mufti and the mustafti and his shurut and how to benefit from the textual evidences. These two is not the definition of usul al-fiqh. Really, the definition of usul al-fiqh is qawa'id al-ijmaliyah faqat. That's the haqiqah and the reality of usul al-fiqh. If a person just says, usul al-fiqh, what is it? Qawa'id al-ijmaliyah. That's it, he gave you a definition of usul al-fiqh. Should we expand on it even more? This is the correct definition of usul al-fiqh. It is al-qawa'id. It is al-qawa'id. التي يعرف بها الحكم الشرعي الطلبي الاجتهادي. It is القواعد. It is principles in which through those principles, التي يعرف بها, the person will come to know الحكم الشرعي, the jurisprudent rulings. الطلبي, when we say الطلبي, what we getting rid of? Al-Khabari, we don't want Khabari to enter here. Khabari has got nothing to do with Usul al-Fiqh. It's Talabi, the requested ones. Al-Ijtihadiyu. The reason why we're adding Ijtihad here is because we said that the Fuqaha, they see Ijtihad is not a condition here, alone. They believe it's which Ijtihad or none Ijtihad, no problem. And Ijtihad, what does it mean, brothers? Ma ma'ana al-Ijtihad? What's the difference between Ijtihad and Ikhtilaf? Hey, who knows what's the difference between ijtihad and ikhtilaf? Yeah.
Ikhtilaf can be based on any evidences. Ijtihad is when both of them have an evidence.
Based. So ijtihad means... Ijtihad means both parties are using evidences. This is what ijtihad means. Ikhtilaf means one is using evidence and the other one has no evidence. Are you with me? Ikhtilaf means a party doesn't have evidence for what he's saying. Or he hasn't come across this evidence. Or he did a qiyas, an analogy, because he thought there was no evidence for this. And then pop came a hadith that was found after that already stated a ruling opposite to his analogy. Are you with me? Are you all with me, brothers? A scholar comes today, he gives a ruling in a matter. He says, this is the hukum. Based on his analogy, qiyas, he does qiyas. Gives a qiyas. And then what happens is, years later, he passes away, scholars come out and they find a hadith in this particular matter. No one knew this hadith at that time. Somebody came across a hadith and he narrated an authentic hadith. Are you with me, brothers? What do we do to the qiyas that was there? This qiyas was an opinion. Qiyas is a adilla far'iyya, it's a sub-branch. This individual has brought an adilla asliya, he brought sunnah. Are you with me? The qa'idah is what? إِذَا جَاءَ نَهْرُ اللَّهِ إِذَا جَاءَ نَهْرُ اللَّهِ بَطَلَ نَهْرُ مِعْقَلْ. The qa'idah is, if the river of Allah comes, no one wants the river of Mi'qal anymore. صح? Mi'qal was a guy who used to take money from people. He had a little stream or a little well. He used to charge the people. He'd say, look, people, give me money and you can have the water. So he used to charge them. So people used to buy the water from him. And guess what? One day Allah brings rain and a river starts flowing. Are people going to go pay money to Mi'qal and give him money? Are they? Because Allah's river came. That's what qiyas is. Qiyas is used when there's no water. When the nahrul of Allah comes, we say, Mi'qal, respect to you, admiration. We've got free water now, sah? So the qa'idah is, لَجْتِهَادَ بِمَوْرِدِ النَّصِ. لَجْتِهَادَ بِمَوْرِدِ النَّصِ. لَا اِجْتِهَادَ بِمَوْرِدِ النَّصِ. There is no ijtihad when there is a nas. No one's allowed to strive and bring a ruling out if there's a dalil. Does that make sense? The dalil takes precedence over anybody's statement. That's what ijtihad means. Then the author, rahimahullah, after defining what usulul fiqh means, he mentions to us the chapters of this book. What is he going to mention? Are you with me, brothers? What are we going to study? And what are we going to go through? He mentions Aqsamul Kalami, Amr, Nahi, Aam, Khas, Mujmal, Mubayyan, Zahir, Muawwal, Af'al, Nasikh, Mansuq, Ijma', Al-Akhbar, Al-Qiyas, Al-Hadr, Al-Ibaha, Tartib Al-Adila, Sifatul Mufti Wal-Mustafti, Ahkamul Mujtahideen. They're different, the copies are different. So the author, rahimahullah, he's going to mention them. So there's no need for me to mention each one, what it means, because there are chapters that are going to come. The order that he's going to do it in is the order he mentioned already, Aqsamul Kalam. These are now, we've now taken so far what, brothers? What have we taken so far? We took usul, fiqh, usul al-fiqh. That's all we did. That's all we did now. Are you with me, brothers? We're now going into usul al-fiqh chapters. I already broke it down for you. Every dalala that I mentioned, you look for where it's in now. So he's going to mention some adilla asliya, adilla far'iyya. He's going to bring them. He's going to talk about that. And he's going to talk about dalalat. And he's also going to be talking about tartib al-adilla, which is the issue of what? At-ta'arud wa tarjih. We're going to go into that. So now we're going to start the first one with... Yeah, we're going to do a quiz now. So then now we're going to start the chapter of Al-Kalam, speech. Because Usul al-Fiqh and the deals with what? Quran and Sunnah. That's where it's taken from, right? And the Quran and Sunnah are speech. So how do we deal with the speech? We're going to now go into that. Before we do the quiz. Okay. We had a long break. Some people forgot what was happening. That's what I wanted. Without any looking. Oh, no look. What's the difference? If you tell me in Arabic, it's good. If you define it in Arabic, that will be two questions in one. Sorry, three questions in one. If you don't, then there's two more questions left for you. You see, Arabic, look how powerful it is. It's a powerful language. It has to be treated different from English. Okay, what's the definition of usul al-fiqh? Hiya. هيا the full version, we want the full version. التي طريقها الاجتهاد. Full version, we want the full text. We want the definition we gave. أي تفضل. القواعد الإجمالية التي يعرف بها حكم أو
حكم
شرعي. حكم
last time said أحكام but this time
said حكم. أه أصير حكم يا right now did I say حكم؟ Okay, hey, say أحكام. Hey, if you say حكم, no, it's not a problem. That's باعتبار أفراده. But so it's good to look at. Hey, لفظ هي.
الأحكام الشرعية.
الأحكام الشرعية.
الطلبية.
الطلبية.
الاجتهادية.
الاجتهادية نعم. ما شاء الله. Okay, let's go into the next chapter. Inshallah, تعالى. تفضل.
فأما أقسام الكلام فأقل ما يتركب من الكلام اسمان نحو زيد قائم أو اسم وفعل أو فعل وحرف أو اسم وحرف والكلام ينقسم إلى أمر ونهي وخبر واستخبار وينقسم أيضا إلى تمن نحو ليت الشباب وعرض نحو ألا تنزل عندنا وقسم نحو والله لأفعلن كذا ومن وجه آخر ينقسم إلى حقيقة والمجاز فالحقيقة ما بقي على موضوعه فصل الأمر استدعاء الفعل بالقول ممن هو دونه على سبيل الوجوب وصيغته أفعل نحو اضرب وهي افعل نحو اضرب وهي عند الإطلاق والتجرد عن القرينة.
You jumped a lot, right? Yeah? You jumped the page?
نعم.
Yeah, okay.
ومن وجه آخر إلى ينقسم إلى حقيقة ومجاز فالحقيقة ما بقي على موضوعه وقيل ما استعمل فيما استرها عليه من المخاطبة والمجاز ما تجوز به عن موضوعه والحقيقة إما أن يكون لغوياً وإما شرعية وإما عرفية والمجاز إما أن يكون بزيادة أو نقصان أو نقل أو استعارة فالمجاز بالزيادة كقوله تعالى ليس كمثله شيء والمجاز بالنقصان كقوله تعالى واسأل القرية أي أهل القرية والمجاز بالنقل كالغاية يستعمل فيما يخرج من الإنسان والمجاز بالاستعارة
فيما يخرج
من الإنسان والمجاز بالاستعارة كقوله تعالى جدارا يريد أن ينقض فأقامه.
The author رحمه الله تعالى now he starts the first chapter from the chapters of Usul al-Fiqh that he starts with is Aqsamul Kalam, categorizing speech. The reason why he started with Kalam is because, as I said before, Ahkamul Shar'iyyah is built upon what? Ala Kalamillahi wa Kalam Rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you want to understand Allah's Kalam and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Kalam, you have to know the different types of speeches there are, according to the Arabs. Because we know, فَإِنَّ الشَّرِيعَةَ عَرَبِيَّةٌ The Sharia is Arabic. كَمَا قَرَّرَهُ الْإِمَامُ الشَّاطِبِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ في كتابه الموافقات. As Imam al-Shatibi mentions in his kitab al-Muwafaqat. This is the Arabic language book, religion. So the person who wants to understand this religion has to know the Arabic language and understand what it is. And the person, my beloved brothers and sisters, who doesn't learn the Arabic language, تُمْنَعُ عَلَيْهِ كَثِيرٌ مِنْ مَعَارِفِ الشَّرِيعَةِ. Wallahi, you're going to be deprived. Wallahi, you're going to lose out of and lose understanding a lot of the Islamic religion, the Islamic knowledge. However much books are translated in the English language, it's going to be nothing. Jazakallah khairan. It's going to be nothing, and you won't truly understand it unless you learn the Arabic language. ولذلك أبو محمد ابن حزم, he said a very powerful statement. He said, كيف يؤمن على الشريعة؟ How can he believe in this Sharia? من لا يؤمن على العربي على اللسان العربي. The one who doesn't believe in the Arabic language. Very powerful statement. The one who believes in the Sharia. How can one believe in the Sharia? كيف يؤمن على الشريعة؟ من لا يؤمن على اللسان العربي. How can one believe in the Sharia who doesn't believe in the Arabic language? ولذلك the scholars بإجماع consensus. لا يجوز له الإفتاء, is not permissible to do a fatwa and extract rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah, the one who doesn't know the Arabic language. Rather, لا يعد من أهل الفقه, the person is not considered from the people of fiqh if he doesn't know the Arabic language. And the kalam of Al-Imam Abu Muhammad ibn Hazm is haq wallahi, is true. Because this sharia is Arabic. How could you believe in this religion and take it serious if you don't even know its language? Because the iman of something is, it comes from knowing what you're believing in. So a person should give time to learning the Arabic language. The author categorized the speech into three. He looked at it in three different ways. Pay attention to this. First type, he categorized it, تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يترتب منه. أما ما يتركب منه اعتبار الك... He divides it, تقسيم الكلام, dividing the speech باعتبار ما يتركب منه, categorizing the speech in terms of what it's compounded of. Are you with me, brothers? In terms of what it's compounded of, the speech, when you look at the speech of the Arabics, the Arabs, it's what we would say in Nahu, وَأَقَلُّ مَا يَتَأَلَّفُ مِنْهُ الْكَلَامِ. And as you know, brothers and sisters, the Arabs, their speech is in three things. It's ism, fi'il, and harf. It's a noun, it's a verb, and it's a particle. Ibn Malik says, كَلَامُنَا لَفْظٌ مُفِيدٌ كَاسْتَقِمْ وَاسْمٌ وَفِعْلٌ ثُمَّ حَرْفٌ الْكَلِمْ واعده كلمة والقول عام وكلمة بها كلام قد يؤم بالجر والتنوين والندى وأل ومسند للإسم تميز حصل. The كلام, when he says كلامنا, أي نحن معاشر النحاة, that's what he means, كلامنا. شرف الدين العمريطي in his نظم of الجرومية, he says كلامهم, أي هم معاشر النحاة, the grammarians. You see how Ibn Malik, he said kalamuna, he didn't say al-kalamu. If we bought the alif al-lam, the alif al-lam would have taken the job of the na. Does it make sense? Because this noon is iwadun an, it takes the place of the al. The al is ahdiya, the grammarians, the ones you know. Kalamuna inahnu luhad. According to our speech is what? Kalamuna lafzun mufidun kastaqim. Wasmun. وَاسْمٌ اسم وَاسْمٌ وَفِعْلٌ ثُمَّ حَرْفٌ الْكَلِمْ. So these are the three the speech consists of. Okay, you with me, brothers? نعم. Now what's the minimum that an Arab speech can be? What's the minimum? أَقَلُّ مَا يَتَرَتَّبُ مِنْهُ. That's what we're going to speak about when we come to this one. The first categorization. The second type of categorization of the speech is, we're looking at speech from different angles, صح? If you look at me today, you can look at me from many different angles. You can look at one time, you can look at me from the angle of my height. That's one way of looking at me. You can look at me from the angle of my complexion. You can look at me from the angle of my size and my weight. There's many ways of looking at a person. Speech, when we look at it from many different angles. So one time they're looking at it from the angle of how the structure and how it's compounded. Are you with me? It's also been now looked at from the angle, other angle is taqseemul kalami bi'tibari madlulihi. Ma ma'ana bi-madluli? Speech, what it shows. The meaning in which it gives us. Madlulihi means al-ma'ana alladhi dalla alayhi. The meaning in which it is indicated for us. The third categorization that the author here brings is taqseemul kalami, categorizing speech. بِاعْتِبَارِ اسْتِعْمَالِهِ categorizing speech in terms of its usage, how the speech is used. Those are the three categorizations that the author is going to mention here when he says أَقْسَامُ الْكَلَامِ. أَقْسَامُ الْكَلَامِ, how many did he divide it into speech? He divided it into three. The first one was تَقْسِيمُ الْكَلَامِ بِاعْتِبَارِ مَا يَتَرَكَّبُ مِنْهُ. The second one was تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله. The third one was تقسيم الكلام باعتبار استعماله. Each one there's going to come types under it, don't worry. Let's go back to the first one now, which is categorizing speech in what? باعتبار ما يتركب منه, that which it consists of. The author mentions رحمه الله تعالى, he says فأقل ما يتركب منه الكلام اسمان أو اسم وفعل أو اسم وحرف أو فعل وحرف. He mentioned four. The minimum the Arab speech consists of is four, he mentions. The first one is two nouns. اسمان كلام مركب من اسمين. A kalam, a speech that consists of what? Two nouns. That's the first. Or the second one. The second one is kalamun, a speech. Murakkabun, that is compounded of min fi'lin wa ismin, a verb and a noun. A verb and a noun. Are you with me, brothers? The third one is كلامٌ, a speech. مُرَكَّبٌ, that is compounded of حَرْفٍ وَاسْمٍ, a particle and a noun. The fourth one is كلامٌ مُرَكَّبٌ مِنْ حَرْفٍ وَفِعْلٍ, is compounded of a particle and a verb. These are the four types in which the author mentions for what the Arab speech consists of. The first two he's right, which is two nouns. Example for that is الدين النصيحة. الدين النصيحة is two ismain. الدين is a noun. نصيحة is a noun. أقل ما يتركب منه الكلام. Two nouns, is the minimum speech a person can say. Can it be two nouns? نعم. The first one is tick. The second one, which is, it consists of, is compounded of what? A verb and a noun, such as جاء الحق. The truth came. جاء فعل ماضي مبني على الفتح لا محل له من العرابي. الحق اسم جاء مرفوع وعلامة رفعه ضمة ظاهرة على آخره, صح؟ That's how it is, brothers. Okay. جاء الحق فعل واسم صحيح. Tick as well. That's أقل ما يتركب منه الكلام. The next two that the author brought, which is حرف واسم. Example would be يا رب Ya Rabbu. Ya is a harfu nida. Rabbu is a noun. That's it. He's got it. He's saying, this is my reason why I'm saying harfun wasmun. Are you with me, brothers? But that's wrong. That is incorrect. The reason is because the word ya, it's actually not what's there. When the Arabs, they say ya Rabb, the word ya is a iwad, it's taking the place of unadi Rabbi, I am calling unto my Lord, unadi. Are you with me, brothers? It's taking the place of what? Fi'il and an ism. So it takes us back to the second one. Sah. The next one is what? The next one is harf and a fi'il. This is also incorrect. Such as example is maqama. He didn't stand. Are you with me? Maqama is not two, it's three. Because you were talking about Zayd, right? And I then said maqama, he didn't stand. What do I mean? Maqama Zaydun. Are you with me? Because you can't just come to somebody and say maqama. Can you? It won't be kalam which is mufid. He didn't stand, you can't just say that. It comes after you were both talking about somebody. So that person's name is in the sentence even though it's not been mentioned. Sah is muqaddar. Are you with me, brothers? So what the scholars, they say is the last two that he mentioned, they all enter the first two. It's only the minimum an Arab speech can be is either two nouns or a verb and a noun, faqat. This view that the author has is a madhab that some people have. It's a madhab min al-madahib, who believe that ya Rabbu is a what? Harfun wasmun. And maqama is harf and a fi'il, and that is aqallu ma yatarakkabu minhu al-kalam. This qawl goes against the qawl of the jumhur al-nuhat, the majority of the grammarians. And the kufiyun, they blast this belief. He's taking the opinion of the who? The Basriyun. Are we all together on that? Shall we now move on to the second type of categorization of speech? The second type of categorization of speech is Aqsamul Kalami bi'i'tibari what? Ya brothers, bi'i'tibari madlulihi, in terms of what meaning does it give to us, right? Are we all together, brothers? How many types did the author mention here? He mentions amrun, wa nahiyun, wa khabarun, wa istikhbarun. He mentions those, right? Tamannin, wa ardin, wa qasamin. All of that he mentions there. All of that is what he mentioned. Let's explain each one. And let's then summarize it all. All of that which he said, how many types did he mention? Amr, nahi, khabar, istikhbar, tamannin, ardin, qasam. How many did he mention? He mentioned seven, right? All seven of those go back to two. We should make it easy, right? All seven of those just go back to two things. It's either khabar or it's insha. Khabar or insha'a. Sah.
Professionalism, don't worry. Been doing this for a while. I'm tired, brothers, wallahi. I have to have energy drink. Yeah? You want me to cancel the class or have an energy drink?
energy drink, right? It goes back to two things. Are you with me, brothers? The first is al-khabar. It goes back to khabar or insha. What does khabar mean, or what does insha mean? Khabar means qawlun. It's a speech. يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب. This is the ta'rif al-mukhtar. This is the chosen definition that we're going to give it. That the khabar is qawlun, a speech. يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب. Either it being truthful or it being a lie is present. It has to take one of the two. Are you with me, brothers? It's any speech that a person, anything a person says, which you can say to him, kadib. Or you can say, sidq. This is called khabar. If I say to Akhi Kale, can you say to me, bela shakti? Can you say you lied? Can you say that to me? No, because it's not khabar. Khabar is qawlun yalzamuhu sidqu aw al-kadib. Insha, the other hand, is what? No, we left that definition. The reason why we left it is because those who say, when I said ma yalzamuhu, if I had said like him, مَا يَحْتَمِلُ, if I use the word ihtimal, then I would have to bring لِذَاتِهِ. Are you with me, brothers? عند التحقيق, the strongest definition is this. You know why? Because according to a definition, it has to be summarized, aslan. Those who say مَا احْتَمَلَ الصِّدْقَ أَوِ الْكَذِبَ لِذَاتِهِ, this ta'rif is ضعيف, saqim. The reason why they brought لِذَاتِهِ is because they want to take Allah's speech out of it.